all modern digital chips have a clock built in. And I don't mean a clock that tells UTC time, but instead I mean a physical wire routed globally all around the chip that oscillates between on and off at a constant frequency. And when I mean on and off, that usually means a voltage potential of 0 volts and 1 volt. For example, here is a basic GPU I designed, and you can see this white line is my clock wire routed around the chip that does its oscillations 12 million times per second, also known as 12 megahertz, which sounds pretty fast, but is actually about 500 times slower than cutting-edge processors. But if we zoom in to what the clock wire is connected to, we find the subject of today's video, flip-flops. A flip-flop is a digital circuit element that stores a single bit of data once it is triggered by a clock edge. And flip-flops are required for sequential logic operations. So many modern designs can have hundreds of thousands of flip-flops, making flip-flops one of the most important digital devices. So in this video, I will try to give a comprehensive introduction to flip-flops so you know how to use them in your own designs. Oh, and side note, when I say flip-flop, I'm referring to delay flip-flops, or D flip-flops. The JK flip-flop and T flip-flop are considered purely historical at this point, except for their genuine application in Minecraft redstone circuits. But anyways, on with the video. All right, here is a waveform of a basic sequential counter. And you can notice it's sequential because the counter value increments every time the clock completes one oscillation, also known as a clock cycle. And if we look at the circuit, you can see that we have two flip-flops that output the count that is then fed into an adder. Then every time the clock value changes from 0 to 1, also known as a rising edge or pause edge, the adder output is now stored in the flip-flops, becoming the new count. So on every new cycle, the count value increments. And also, something people usually do with visual schematics like this is to just visually combine related flip-flop cells. So here's the exact same circuit, but now with the two flip-flops combined into one 2-bit register. And this is just a more common and more concise way of drawing schematics. And from this point forward, I will be using the terms register and flip-flop interchangeably. Now, I want to make a clear distinction between a similar memory device called a latch. Like flip-flops, latches can also store one bit of data, but latches are not activated by a clock edge, but instead allow data to pass through anytime the enable is held high. This asynchronous behavior of latches can lead to timing hazards and race conditions in complex circuits, making them less predictable and harder to debug compared to flip-flops. So as a result, modern circuit design highly favors flip-flops over latches for their superior predictability and ease of debugging, even though flip-flops do require a few more transistors than latches. But let me now show you the SystemVerilog code that implements this counter circuit using flip-flops. You can see this module creates a register by creating signals count underscore D and count underscore Q to represent the D input and the Q output of a flip-flop. Then there's an always flip-flop block driven on the clock pause edge, where count D is assigned to count Q. Then finally, here is the combinational logic to perform the addition and assign the module output. And I have three quick best practices to mention about creating flip-flops. The first is that you should always name your flip-flop signals with the suffixes underscore D and underscore Q to reflect the widely popular low-risk coding style. Many of the most popular SystemVerilog codebases also follow this practice, so staying consistent with them all will drastically improve the readability of your code for others. The second best practice is that you should only use non-blocking assignments inside of always flip-flop blocks. This is because in a physical chain of flip-flops, the flip-flops will all update at the exact same time, but in a SystemVerilog simulation with blocking assignments, flip-flops are modeled to update independently of each other, which can lead to simulation race conditions. Non-blocking assignments ensure that all always flip-flop blocks update their data at the exact same time to not cause any simulation synthesis mismatches. And the final best practice is you should really keep all your combinational logic separate from your always flip-flop block. I know it can be tempting to reduce your code into fewer lines, but it provides much clearer and debuggable code to keep your combinational logic in your always comb blocks and keep your flip-flop instantiations in your always flip-flop blocks. And those are the three best practices to follow when creating flip-flops in SystemVerilog. And with that, we can finally synthesize this design. I'm using the Digital.js Visual Studio Code extension, and we can see our register and adder were properly inferred. But oops, it looks like count is actually not incrementing in this simulation. And that's because the simulation never initialized this count register. So its simulated value is unknown. And in Verilog simulation, 1 plus an unknown value is still unknown. So every cycle, the flip-flop appears to not be doing anything, even though the circuit itself is valid. Now, you could use an initial block to initialize your register, but this should be avoided because it is not synthesized on ASICs. Therefore, I will show you a better way to initialize your circuit. And this is where I share that I've been lying to you just a little bit. Yes, all digital circuits have a clock signal, but all clock signals are also paired with a global reset signal that goes active usually just once when initially powering on your circuit. So let me add this to our system Verilog by adding a reset input and if statement to our always flip-flop block. And the reset can either be active high, meaning the flip-flops are reset when the reset signal is 1, or it can be active low, meaning the flip-flops are reset when the reset signal is 0. And according to most coding styles, including the low-risk coding style, you should add an underscore n to denote when a signal is active low. And now our circuit works. But actually, there are two types of reset signals, synchronous and asynchronous. This is a synchronous signal because it will only affect the queue output after each clock edge, but an asynchronous signal will affect the queue output immediately. In System Verilog, asynchronous signals can be created by adding pause edge or neg edge reset in your always flip-flop sensitivity list. And here's a website I built to simulate these different types of flip-flops. And you can see what the waveform of an asynchronous reset will look like versus here is the waveform of a synchronous reset. Now, it is beyond the scope of this video to explain when one or the other type of reset is preferred, but it is crucial to match the design practices followed in the project you are working on. And if it's your project, then just pick whichever is your favorite right now and stick to it. And while I'm on this simulator webpage, you can see these red boxes on the D input signal. And these boxes represent the timing aperture before each clock pulse that the D signal should not change between. When you run your design through place and route, the tools will automatically ensure that the combinational logic in your flip-flops will settle before the setup time, and it will also make sure that the signal will not move until the hold time has been satisfied. Otherwise, your queue output will be undefined. Plus, this blue line here represents the clock to queue delay for the queue value to actually update after the clock pulse happens. And another cool feature that I added to this page is that you are provided an auto-generated gate-level schematic of what each flip-flop implementation looks like. And notice the leader-follower structure, with each latch having a pair of bistable inverters. And when the clock is low, the leader latch is precharged. Then when the clock transitions to high, the leader latch is disabled and the follower latch is enabled. And that's how the data seems to only change on clock edges. And notice that this schematic is different from many schematics found in intro digital design textbooks. Many textbooks opt to show more inefficient flip-flop designs in order to build off of their previous lessons. But I think there's something special about seeing the real structure of flip-flops that are used in actual chips. But that's just my opinion. And that concludes this overview of flip-flops. Feel free to like, comment, and subscribe, and I'll see you in the next video.